It is time to go speedway racing for the FARC Smash Beer Lowe Dollar Series, as round 7 of the 2016 championship brings us to the Darlington Raceway in South Carolina, the first intermediate oval on the schedule, and there could hardly be a more difficult oval than this one, with two high-banked asymmetrical corners, a very narrow racing surface, and the preferred groove that is right next to the outside wall. There are few ovals in the world more challenging than Darlington, and it is sure to bring out the best of the 36 drivers in this field here today. As we take a look at the starting lineup, Lev Azarov earned the Karls P1 award in qualifying, his first pole of the season. On the outside of the front row is Jason Bates, Billy Ray Smith Thompson and Monica Rook make up row 2, Kenny George III, the highest qualifying rookie, and we have a pair of rookies in row 3 with Naomi Almaco on his outside, Dan Lecklider and Kevin Monroe, Monroe a previous Darlington winner in row 4, Thomas Tucker and Riley Durbin rounding out the top 10 starters. Looking at 11 through 20, we have Todd Stater on the inside of row 7, the Daytona winner and the current points leader. He qualified just ahead of the Team Thunder teammates of Griffith and Steffens. And on the outside of row 9, we have Jacob Eichholz in the 31 car, making his first start in the series in quite some time. Zach Gott and Mark Thompson make up row 22, Thompson the winner at Elko Speedway a few weeks ago. Taylor Brillen all the way back in 28th, that's not a very good qualifying run from another former winner at this track. Series veteran Kurt Walker in 29th, with Gio Arias, the Ike Durbin Incorporated rookie on his outside. And towards the back of the field, we have Davey Carter and Allison Weatherby, a pair of debutantes in row 16. John Burr, qualifying for another race on speed in 33rd. And rounding out the field, we have Zach Denman and Barry Woods, another debutante driver Barry Woods is. They were the fastest 36 cars in qualifying. There weren't any heats this week. And the seven drivers that will be going home include Todd Lacey, the first man out. Not much of a surprise there. Lacey hasn't shown much speed all season. Zach Webster, that's a surprise because he has been very fast in this series. A big shame for Webster to have to go home early. And we have Tom Brayton, Troy Peterson, Michael Day, Ronnie Holter, and Montgomery Carlo, all of whom were well off the pace in qualifying. We now go trackside from here at the Darlington Raceway for the highlight coverage of the ProLaps 100, Race 7 of the 2016 FARC Smash Beer Low Dollar Series, where Lev Azarov and Jason Bates lead the field of 36 to the green flag, and it's a very good start for Bates, pulling ahead on the outside and jumping into the lead into Turn 1. Monica Rook started from 4th, and she's trying to follow Bates on the outside of Azarov and into 2nd place. She gets a nice run off of Turn 2 down the backstretch, and off Turn 4 at the end of the first lap, she's going to blast by the 82, leaving Azarov to deal with Almaco and Smith-Thompson in the battle for 3rd now. Almaco, that purple and silver car, off to a very good start this weekend, but Azarov and Smith-Thompson are going to drive right by her on the inside of Turn number 1. And off the corner, Azarov smacks the wall hard. That was some pretty significant contact to the outside wall, and Azarov is going to be the first driver of the day to earn the Darlington stripe. As the 82 continues to fall back, it's been a very rough start for your pole sitter, but not quite as bad as that of Kira Smith. The 89 car for Terra International Motorsports reports the pit lane on the very first lap with some unknown issues. That team is going to spend the entire race trying to get the car repaired, and they're never going to rejoin the track. As Jason Bates begins to open up an early lead, this 69 car for Wild West Racing, of course, won last week at Road America, with Tristan Kristoff behind the wheel. And all of a sudden, Monica Rook has caught up right to the 69 car. She made up the gap between herself and Bates very quickly. But now that she's caught the 69 car, she is having a hard time getting around him. As you can see, it is a very narrow racing groove here at Darlington. Passing is a bit more of a methodical process, and definitely a more challenging one than at many other ovals. And it seems that Rook is having a bit of a hard time trying to take the lead from him, and now Billy Ray Smith Thompson has caught up to this group, making it a 3-car battle for the lead. These three drivers have left a lot of distance already between themselves and Dan Lecklider. Lecklider currently runs in 4th, and himself has pulled the ways quite a bit from Todd Stater and Bob Steffens, who currently battle for 5th. And right behind those two drivers is the rest of the field, running very closely together, just as they were on the start. Stater worked his way all the way up into the top 5 from a 13th place starting position, and right behind him, Steffens started from 15th place, so these two drivers on the move early on in the going. Dropping through the field in the other direction, on the other hand, is the pole sitter, Lev Azarov, who is still losing positions left and right, or mostly left, I should say, and he's going to receive a little bit of a bump from Mark Thompson, turning himself across the front of Riley Durbin. That was almost a crash. but it's been a disastrous start for Azarov, and we're not sure how much of that has to do with the damage to the right side of his car. Back up at the front, Monica Rook finds an opportunity to go to the inside of Jason Bates. He leaves the bottom open through turns 1 and 2. Of course, the top side can be the preferred line, but it looks like Bates couldn't quite keep power down. Not early enough to stay ahead of the 22 at least. Smith Thompson goes through past Bates, and it looks like Rook might have actually been holding up Smith Thompson too, because the 2 car is now going for the lead himself. Going to the inside of Rook through turn number 2, and Smith Thompson is going to put the famous Smash Beer number 2 machine at the head of the field. The former FARC Truck Series racer and NRC driver finding a lot of speed at the Pearson Sweeney stable this year. Todd Stater is going to bounce off the wall in turn 4 from 5th place and give a couple of spots to Bob Steffens and Mike Malone, and Malone spins up turn 1 and into the outside wall, all on his own. Fortunately, no one else is going to get involved. Here comes traffic, but they're all going to get around him without any further troubles. Malone dove onto the apron on corner entry, and the car completely stepped out from underneath him, and he pancaked the outside wall quite significantly, but he's not going to even hit the pits for repairs. Ashley Tucker picked up a lot of positions in that ordeal, and now she is running in 6th place. Tucker started all the way back in 29th, and has picked up more ground than any other driver thus far. As we look at the flyby camera off of turn 2, there goes your top 5 drivers. Lecklider still 4th, and Steffens catching him quickly. There's Tucker in 6th, and Stater still leads the rest of the field as they go flying by, attaining very high speeds around the 25 degree banks of turns 1 and 2. Bob Steffens is not going to take long to catch up to Dan Lecklider in the battle for 4th, but through turn 2, something's going to go wrong with the 7 car. He slows considerably and immediately pulls it to the apron, and as the rest of the field goes flying by, there goes Steffens' chances of getting a good result and possibly a victory. Suspension problems on the 7 car are going to take him out of the race. A big shame for Steffens and the Team Thunder crew. The first car to go a lap down is the number 40 for Coleman's Outlaws. This week it's being driven by Barry Woods, who is making his first start in the series, but he has been far from impressive all weekend long and is completely impeding Billy Ray Smith-Thompson. Monica Rook catches all the way back up to him in moments time and is now pressuring him for the lead when he really should have been running away from the field. Woods does not have a fast car underneath him, but he's been far from impressive all weekend long. He goes into the wall through turn number 3. Getting out of the way of the leaders, Bates has caught up to top 2 runners at this point. But again, Woods has been in the wall several times already despite having a slow car. I honestly have no idea how he managed to outqualify Zach Webster, or even Todd Lacey for that matter. Jason Bates takes second place back as he gets around Monica Rook. So Woods inadvertently cost Rook a position there, and he's in the wall again through turn number 4. Lecklider's already gotten by him. There goes Stater. But trouble strikes when the rest of the field comes up to lap him. We mentioned multiple times already how hard it is to pass here, and he's going to hold up many cars at once. Taylor Brillin, Rebel Denman, Naomi Almaco, all stuck behind the 40 car, and Brillin not going to have any of it. She turns the 40 off at turn number 2 and into the inside wall down the backstretch. Woods goes spinning, and that's going to bring out the first caution of the race. We had a long green flag run going to start off the event, but on lap 17, the first yellow comes out when Brillin decides she's had enough of Woods impeding her after only a few seconds. Monica Rook wins the race off of pit row. The entirety of the field came in for fresh tires and fuel. Smith Thompson comes out second with Zach Gott and Kelly Splicen moving up into third and fourth, but Jason Bates in the 69 and Todd Stater had disastrous pit stops. They came into the pits from the top 5 and are going to restart outside the top 20. Whatever went wrong with their pit stops, they now have a lot of work to do if they're going to get back to the front. As Rook leads on the restart, Barry Woods now a lap down, starting on the inside, and is going to be right in everyone's way right off the start. So that's something everyone behind him is going to have to worry about. There he goes into the wall again off of turn number 2. Woods brings sponsorship to this team from his business. He is a clown for a day job, and Riley Durbin goes spinning right behind them. The 93 car got turned to the inside. Let's take another look at what happened there. Running off of turn number 2, Durbin comes up on Stanley Parsons, who was held up by the 40, and cuts across Jacob Eichholz as he tries to go to the inside and around them. Minimal damage to the 93 car, but the second caution of the race is also going to be caused by Barry Woods. And during this yellow, Bradley Carlisle brings the 8 car into the pits. The Pearson Sweeney teammate to Billy Ray Smith-Thompson, and the 8 car that won here last year with Lucas Sweeney behind the wheel. On the restart, we have the 67 car of Davey Carter trying to move around Zach Gott and into third place. Carter making his first start in the series as Woods goes hard into the wall again. The 67 car for David Hetzel Racing Enterprises has featured a rotation of drivers all throughout the year, and Carter is putting on the best performance yet among those drivers, running in third in the opening stages here at a very difficult racetrack. Zach Gott, who he had to pass to earn that position, is still stuck behind Woods in the 40 car. Woods sure has been driving like a clown, and he's going to cause another crash. Gott goes around across the front of the 66 of Todd Stater down the backstretch as Woods went into the wall again. Luckily for Gott, he's not going to hit anything else. But into turn three, trying to get away from that, Kurt Walker's going to dive out of the apron. He's not slowing down, back up into traffic, and takes many cars into the outside wall. Kenny George III's around, Lev Azarov, Ashley Tucker, Taylor Brillen, and Stanley Parsons were among the other cars collected. Walker didn't have enough room to fall back in lines on the backstretch, but he decided to try and make the corner anyway on the inside, which, of course, is unbanked. Billy Bob Childers got into Bradley Carlisle right behind this, and that was actually a separate incident than the one that Walker caused. A lot more cars were involved in those two accidents in turn three than the one that brought out the caution when Zach Gott went spinning. On the restart, Rook still leads, and Davey Carter goes right by Billy Ray Smith-Thompson in the second place. Not sure what kind of experience Carter has outside of FARC, but he's really impressing here this weekend. And Barry Woods, guess who's going to cause the next caution of the race? He bounces off into Mark Thompson, who collects Kurt Walker again as they spin down the backstretch, and you saw Lev Azarov hit the 98 as he went spinning. Not sure what happened to the 82. Let's take a look at that. His day's already gone badly enough as it is, and he gets hit by Taylor Brillen while trying to avoid that. Naomi Alnaco again. Kenny George III also goes spinning. You can tell just by looking at these cars how rough of a race that they've had. And Barry Woods, there's got to be a rule for causing a certain number of cautions before you're kicked out, but apparently he hasn't reached that threshold yet. During the caution, Anthony Griffith leads the field into the pits, but Monica Rook, Davey Carter, Billy Ray Smith-Thompson, Todd Stater, and Allison Weatherby are all going to stay out. Weatherby wasn't running anywhere near the front and is going to restart in fifth. Lev Azarov, after getting involved in that accident, sustained even more damage than he had initially, and now his race is finally going to come to an end when the engine lets go down the front stretch. It was a very promising start to the day for Azarov, earning the P1 award, but this is going to be a race that he would like to forget. Weatherby, as I just mentioned, restarted in 5th, and she was running outside the top 25 before that caution, and she is not nearly up to speed with the cars that she's around. This is her first start in the FARC Elite Series. Not sure what kind of experience that she has in stock cars. She is a former Formula Overdrive veteran. She goes into the wall off of turn 2, and look right behind her, Jacob Eichholz and Jeff Wilkins nearly lose it off the corner. Take another look at what happened to them. Oh, Gio Arias got into Eichholz and came right up into the side of the 78. A pretty big hit to the door. Normally that'll knock the car right around, but they both held onto it. And whoa, Eichholz trying to get it back together and back up onto the track. Eichholz making his first start in the series in quite some time. He is, of course, the 2011 Rookie of the Year in the series and the winner of the Rookie Shootout. Barry Woods is going to get himself into even more trouble when he gets turned by Anthony Griffith off of turn 4 and into the outside wall. This incident is really going to set Anthony Griffith back, but it's not going to bring out the caution. I guess the officials are getting impatient with running all of these yellow flag laps for incidents caused by the 40 car, so everyone races on. Todd Stater now trying to get around his teammate for the second position through some pit strategy with all the yellow flags and some perseverance on the racetrack. Stater's worked all the way back up into second, and you see Thomas Tucker trying to get by Carter with him. That would put Tucker into the third spot. Allison Weatherby is still trying to hang on for dear life after restarting from the fifth position. And off of turn number four, she's going to get spun by Kevin Monroe down the front stretch. That's going to bring out the fifth caution of the race on lap 47, just before the halfway point. And for the first time today, we have a caution flag due to an incident not caused by Barry Woods. How about that? Weatherby's going to be able to drive away without any damage, although she's going to have to get some tires changed. And under this caution, the drivers who stayed out during the previous yellow are going to have to service their cars, giving up the positions that they had in the top five, including Rook from the lead. She's led most of the race up to this point. Also under this yellow, Jim Kidd has to pit for an unscheduled stop, as does Stanley Parsons, and Parsons is not going to return to the track. This leaves Thomas Tucker in the lead for the restart, with Chuck Johnson, the 46, running in second, and Kelly Splicen in third. there's a growing list of, growing number, I should say, of drivers on the inside lane. The cars running one lap down or more. Most of them are, of course, damaged from earlier accidents. And speaking of accidents, Allison Weatherby's going to shove Zach Denman into turn number 3, braking a little bit later than the 102 and forcing him to spin into Ashley Tucker in the 64. Davey Carter now finds himself running at the back of the field after having to pit from the top 5 under that caution, so he's got a lot of ground to make up to get back to where he was, but right in front of him, Chid Kidd spins up the turn and wipes out Carter and Burr. The 18 does a roll through the corner, and there's more cars getting involved. Ashley Tucker and Zach Denman have both piled into this mess. A violent crash is going to bring out the caution just past halfway on lap 53. Looking at the replay, Jim Kidd turned way too early into the corner, straight onto the apron, and lost the car when he did so. Obviously flipped over and is able to drive it away somehow. And then Ashley Tucker and Zach Denman, they'd just gotten themselves involved in that little incident half a lap earlier between the both of them, so they were running well behind this, but decide to take evasive action by driving out of the apron instead of slowing down. I'm not sure how they thought that was a good idea. And this is especially shameful for John Burr. It seems every week this year he's made the race in a car that should not be fast enough to do so, only to get wrecked. And Team Burr is not an organization that can afford to have a car wrecked every week. Under the caution, Thomas Tucker, Kelly Splicen, Dan Lecklider, and Jacob Eichholz are all going to pit from the top 10. Tucker, of course, was running in the lead, so now the top spot has been handed to Chuck Johnson of Cat Motorsports. The 46 team, whichever team name that they are running under, seems to have suffered from some very, very bad luck in the past several years. But this race is definitely going their way, as Johnson is pulling away from second place Zach Gott. Gott spun earlier on in the going across the front of Todd Stater. That accident was, of course, caused by Barry Woods. But he's recovered very well running in second. And Rebel Denman is now running in third. The teammate to Zach Denman, who just dropped out of the race, the Canadian, doing a very good job today. He finished in 8th last week at Road America, as we've got another crash. Jeff Wilkins gets turned by Anthony Griffith off of turn number 2 down the backstretch, and that's going to collect Kelly Splicen, and oh, there's tire marks. Allison Weatherby also got involved. I was about to say that she made it through, but clearly that was not the case. Here's a look at Weatherby trying to navigate through the spinning cars, and almost made it, but just got nipped by the quarter panel of the 78, and sent for another spin. But Weatherby's going to be able to continue once more. On the restart, Johnson still leading over the 71, but there's going to be another crash very similar to the one that brought up the last caution, as Kurt Walker turns Kenny George III this time around. That's going to collect the 07 again, as George spins against the wall, Splicen and Weatherby having to check up to avoid that. And we did not even get half a lap into that restart, but there's going to be another incident under this caution, as Jeff Wilkins gets hit by Weatherby as the cars that were lagging behind tried to catch up, and Griffith is going to smash into the back of the 762. That's the end of the day for the 07 car, despite getting involved in multiple crashes. It's a collision under caution that takes him out. Also going out of the race is Naomi Alnaco, another one of Rebel Denman's teammates, losing an engine after what has been a very rough race for her. Chuck Johnson and Zach Gott begin to pull away from the rest of the field on the restart, but Johnson hits the wall off of turn number 2, and Zach Gott is ready to take advantage of the opportunity, going right past the 46 and into the lead. Gott trying to bring Gravity Racing Incorporated its first victory this season. The first cars behind Gott and Johnson are Bradley Carlisle, Mark Thompson, and Dan Lecklider. Carlisle and Thompson had their own problems early on in the race, and Thompson's another driver who was sent for a spin, as is Riley Durbin, who doesn't run very far behind the 62. You see Monica Rook and Dan Lecklider battling for position just ahead. Durbin has been having a pretty good season in the FARC Smash Beer Low Dollar Series, running through two different teams on a partial schedule, but has been putting up some very consistent results, as Rook has stormed her way through the back of the field all the way back into the top 10, but has had a very hard time trying to get around Dan Lecklider. She led many laps early on in the going, and has really been the victim of a lot of bad luck this year, has gotten caught up in a lot of other people's accidents when she really should have been running well. And just ahead of her, here she has an opportunity. Lecklider hits the wall off of turn 4, and she makes contact with the 10. Lecklider trying to save it, and he goes into the wall and around. Durbin hits him as he goes spinning down the front stretch. That's going to bring out caution number 10, as Lecklider went spinning across the front of Monica Rook. Both of them went hard in the wall. On board the 63 of Kevin Monroe as he barely avoids the spinning number 10 car. This is not the first time that we've ridden shotgun on the 63 as it barely avoids a crash this season. On the restart, the heavily damaged car of Taylor Brillen is going to impede Chuck Johnson and the rest of the field as Zach Gott runs away from them all, although Brillen quickly dives into the pits and out of their way, and now Johnson going into the wall again through turn 3. He's going to have to be a little more cautious if he's going to have a chance at chasing down the 71. We are with less than 15 laps to go at this point. Monica Rook trying not to get held up too much by Barry Woods, who was still getting in everyone's way, and he's going to get spun again off the front of the 8 of Bradley Carlisle this time, in similar fashion to the first caution of the race. This is the 10th yellow in what has been a rather destructive race, and the 5th one brought out by the 40 car. Now that Taylor Brillen is no longer in the way, Chuck Johnson is able to make another go for the lead on Zach Gott. These two drivers raced against each other in the NPCC late model series a couple years ago, where they both scored multiple victories. In fact, Johnson won the championship, but he hasn't found as much success in FARC so far, granted his career in the series has been rather short. As this run goes on, Johnson is not able to find his way around the 71 and is now starting to lose ground to him. There goes Mark Thompson right by the 46 to take over the second spot. Rebel Denman in the same corner now trying to get around Johnson to move into third. So the 46 car starting to fall off a bit, perhaps it's set up to run well on the shorter runs. Riley Durbin running in fifth behind all of them and trying to catch up. He has opened up a fairly big gap over Kevin Monroe and Gio Arias, Durbin's teammate. Arias has not been having a very good weekend by the standards of Ike Durbin Incorporated, but as you can see, he has a very clean car as he gets around Monroe for 6th, and is now in position to score a top 10 finish. Mike Malone in the 5 car, something might be going wrong with that car. He's slowing up through turn number 4, and off the corner, Jacob Eichholz and Monica Rook are going to get together and send Eichholz spinning down the front stretch. Kelly Splicen and Billy Bob Childers crash hard into the 31, as does Taylor Brillen. Eichholz still spinning down the track, and that's the last of the hits that the 31 car is going to take. Looking at the replay, Eichholz came up off the corner and across the front of the 22 car, turning himself into the wall, but that was not necessarily his fault. Rook was closing in on him very, very quickly. Eichholz obviously had to check up for the 5 car, and this cannot be how he wanted his return to FARC racing to go. Eichholz, Splicen, Childers, and Brillen are all out of the race, and the restart comes with just 5 laps to go, in which Gott leads over Mark Thompson, but into turn number 1, Thompson uses a very good restart to drive to the inside of Gott and take over the lead. For the first time today, he brings Chuck Johnson with him now, the 46 trying to work his way back to the front around the 71 car, as Rebel Denman is right behind them, Gio Arias, Kevin Thompson, and Thomas Tucker now, who's recovered very well from a poorly executed pit strategy. He's running in the top 10 again. And now that Johnson is clear of Gott and Denman, he begins to chase down Mark Thompson for the lead of the race. Going to the inside in turn 3, he wasn't nearly close enough to get alongside the 62, and he runs up into the wall with just 4 laps to go. Chuck Johnson was closing in on the 62, but he's gone into the outside wall in turn number 3, and he's lost a lot of ground at the 62, and has also held up Rebel Denman and Zach Gott in the process. There they go, both by the inside of the 46, and now Gio Arias trying to take a position away. But that might have been the race lost for Chuck Johnson. Thomas Tucker running behind them, and now Trey Ashby running in the top 10. We have not seen Ashby anywhere all day, which is might be a good thing because that means we haven't seen him in any crashes. But it appears that this quiet run for Ashby is going to pay off with a very good result. Billy Ray Smith Thompson gets by him now and leaves the 97 car to fight with the 5, the 63, and the 10. Rebel Denman, still running in the second position, has not been able to make up much time on Mark Thompson, and Zach Gott is not going to wait for him to try and do so. He drives right by the 101 on the inside of turn 1, and look at the gap he's already opened up on him. Gio Arias trying to move his way up into third now. And second on back continues to battle hard for position, but it doesn't appear that Mark Thompson is within reach of any of them. He takes the white flag and begins the final lap of the race. This is only Thompson's third start of the year, and of course his most recent start at Elko Speedway ended with a victory. Two race wins guarantees you a position in the FARC off, and it looks like he's about to obtain that. Here comes Rebel Denman to the inside as Zach got on the white flag lap, taking back the second position from the 71 car. They're definitely not going to have a chance to catch up to the 62 at this point and have resorted to battling each other for second. Thomas Tucker moves into third now, but hits the wall off the corner. That's going to allow Gott and Johnson an opportunity to catch back up, but it looks like Tucker keeps ahead of them long enough to make it into turn 3, But once again, all of these battles are taking place in the rearview mirror of Mark Thompson, who is now rounding the final corner. I'm not sure if M&J Racing are going to find a way for him to contest the FARC off, but I would certainly expect them to try, as Mark Thompson takes his second victory of the 2016 season, and in just his third race. A fantastic job to the entire M&J Racing crew on bringing the 62 team its third victory in the last four races. Mariano Zabala, of course, won at Mosport and finished second at Road America, so that car hasn't finished worse than second in the last four races. Rebel Denman scores his best career finish. The Canadian finishes in second place, right ahead of Thomas Tucker, who scores another good result for the Ashcroft Family Racing team. Zach Gott fell back to fourth in the final lap, but it's still a good run for him as well. Chuck Johnson, another driver who scores a good result, finishing in fifth after contending for the win late in the going. Riley Durbin finishes in sixth, with Billy Ray Smith-Thompson finishing in seventh. Smith-Thompson, of course, led several laps early on. Trey Ashby finishes in eighth, avoiding all of the carnage that took place today and working his way up to that spot from the 26th starting position. Gio Arias puts both IDI cars in the top 10, and Mike Malone, after a pretty rough race of his own, comes home with a top 10 finish in 10th. Todd Stater, the points leader, finishes in 11th, just ahead of Kevin Monroe, the 2008 winner of this race. Brad Carlisle, in the car that won last year's race, finishes in 13th, with Dan Lechleiter in 14th. Jason Bates, after leading the first lap of the race, and several laps after that as well, finishes all the way back in 15th. Kurt Walker got involved in several incidents himself and is able to finish in 16th. Jeff Wilkins in 17th, Kenny George III, with a missing front end of that car, in 18th. Monica Rook, after leading the most laps of anyone in the race, once again is not able to score a result that reflects the efforts that her and her team put forth this weekend, finishing all the way back in 19th. Some very bad luck has plagued the 22 team all season long, and hopefully that luck will turn around soon. Allison Weatherby finishes in 20th. Barry Woods, through all the cautions that we had today, was able to fall only one lap down and somehow manages to finish despite causing 5 of the 11 cautions. And Davey Carter, falling 2 laps down due to repairs to his car, finishes in 22nd. He's the last car to have finished the race. Jacob Eichholz is going to be scored 23rd in his first race of the season in the FARC Smash Beer Low Dollar Series. Kelly Splyson, Billy Bob Childers, Taylor Brillin, Naomi Alnaco, Anthony Griffith also dropped out due to crash damage, as did John Byrd, Jim Kidd, Ashley Tucker, and Zach Denman. All four of them went out in the lap 53 crash. And mechanical problems are what ended the day for Stanley Parsons, Lev Azarov, your pole sitter, Bob Steffens, and Kira Smith. The next race for the FARC Smash Beer Low Dollar Series will be at the first dirt track of the 2016 season. The half-mile 7077 Speedway in Cambridge, Ohio, will host the FARC 7077-100. You can catch the highlights of the race and much more action regarding the Falconer Auto Racing Championships right here on the FARC Racing Network.